St. Francis de Sales, was the Bishop of Geneva, Switzerland in the early 17th century. It was a hotbed of Calvinist Reformation. It was a brutal time in which to live. Catholics persecuting Protestants, Protestants persecuting Catholics. Francis was a man of peace, of joy, of understanding. Once when he was playing cards with a group of friends, one of them said, "Francis, what if you knew that within an hour the Lord would come to end it all? What would you do?" He said, "I'd continue playing cards." Deep within himself, Francis grasped the words of the prophet Isaiah, "You, Lord, are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are the work of your hands." And the promise of Jesus, "I will send you the Holy Spirit, and he will abide with you, be with you always, even in a game of cards." The presence of the Lord. Now, playing cards wasn't as important as evangelizing Calvinist leaders in Geneva's South Square. No, but every moment Francis understood and lived out, every moment is capable of being filled with the hidden presence of God. God, the one in whom we live and move and have our being. You know, it's not a matter of feeling and not one of rational proof. Rather, it's a conviction based upon the promise of Jesus that the Spirit pushing Jesus on would also be deep within us. Does this conviction make a difference? Or if it is nurtured by prayer, if we seek to connect with every relationship that is ours, if we relate His way to the issues of the day, oh, then this conviction of the saving presence makes a huge difference deep within ourselves and also within our world. "You are our Redeemer, Lord," Isaiah said, "not our Rescuer. Oh, we will all suffer the inevitable pitfalls of life." He's our Redeemer. And if this means, first of all, redeeming us from guilt, the Lord also comes to somehow heal our brokenness. Our brokenness. We only need to look deep within ourselves, read the daily newspaper, see the great divisions in the religions of the world. Come, Lord, come and save us. And one of the ways in which the Lord came at Bethlehem now comes when faithful disciples join him in the work of salvation. We are not receivers only of God's salvation. We take part with Christ in the whole work of redemption, when somehow we bring justice and peace and unity and joy to the people who surround us. "Rend the heavens and come down." That's the insistent cry of Advent prayer. Our time of waiting is a time of listening, yes, of watching, but most of all, it's a time of doing, to mirror the way of Jesus, who himself awaits our response. I find that interesting, that as we wait for Jesus to come, he waits for us to come to him. And so, how we do that? We mirror his way. And so when this is the spirit of our Advent waiting, we can rejoice in the season songs and hymns. We can be awed by the lights of Christmas. Wrap presents, greet one another, whether it's Happy Holidays or Merry Christmas. I get so amused by people who get so worried about people saying Happy Holidays. Not everybody's a Christian, but everybody needs to rejoice. Everybody needs to have good times. And so we Christians, we Catholic Christians, should have a profound sense of peace. Yes, we wish it to be Merry Christmas for everybody. But we pray, raise that up to the Lord. But we use it not as a weapon. We use it as an invitation. So when we rejoice in the one who has come, and who comes now, and one who will come one day, where, when, how, it's not really important. It's all hidden in the mystery of God. But he will come again to put it all together. Such is our Advent hope.